All right, joining us on Hot Copy, Senator Serge Osmeña, Chairman of the Senate Committee on Banks, Financial Institutions, and Currencies. Good day to you, Senator Osmeña. All right, Senator Serge, first and foremost, you need to explain this in full because first it started with the alleged insider trading of the Philex shares, then the MVP affidavit, and now you are at Ong Pin's alleged interest in the MRT deal. First, how does this all glue together?
Well, there are common denominators. Number one, they use DBP in all these deals. And DBP extended extremely generous loans on extremely generous terms,
okay,
which is already a violation of Central Bank Circular 472.
Okay.
In the Philex loans alone, there were 10 waivers. They did not have to present their credit history. They didn't have to give their financial statements. They didn't have to. Good Lord.
Yeah.
You might as well give him the money na lang, no? In the MRT deal, they approved the loan to a company that was not in existence.
Okay.
On about December 3, they said, we're approving a loan for $180 million to buy MRT bonds. Who's the borrower? Ah, no, you just hold it in abeyance. We don't have a borrower yet.
Okay.
How can you, exercise banking activities in this manner? The borrower was named 2 weeks later, and it was a $2 company registered in the British Virgin Islands.
Oh my gosh!
So, papahinamin mo itong kumpanya na ito na sa Virgin Islands, paano mo ngayon hahabulin yan? They don't have a local office. We don't even know who their officers were. So, we're investigating this because it's just been a series of very funny type.
Okay.
BS loan eh, kasi inapprove na ng Malacanang.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the first loan that we have where Malacanang issued an executive order, EO 181,
mm-hmm,
that said you're hereby authorized to buy up the bonds,
mm-hmm,
and authorize DBP and Land Bank to lend, mm-hmm, the money.
So the connection to all this is that in all these loans, these questionable loans, Bobby Ong Pin is related in each company.
Yes. In the Philex share, he was the direct borrower.
Exactly.
He admitted that he was the beneficial owner of Delta Ventures Incorporated, Golden Media Incorporated, who borrowed the money from DBP, about 660 million pesos.
Yeah.
In gas, it was his people, those that you saw earlier, Mario Lourdes Torres,
AIVI.
No, not only
yet.
AIVI. There's GAS, Global Air Services, and First Digital Trading, Belsky Inc., mm-hmm, which bought the shares of AIVI, which bought the shares that were in MRT, the bonds in MRT that were held by Ashmore One, Ashmore 2, Presidio Capital, and Elliott of Netherlands.
Okay, all right. So in both those big deals, he is involved?
Yes, definitely.
Okay, let's go back first to the first.
Wait a minute. In fairness to Mr. Bobby Ong Pin, he said, I have nothing to do with gas.
Okay.
Really? So I said, how come it's all your alalays who are signing the documents on behalf of gas? Attorney Ponferrada, Josephine Manalo, why? Oh, we did that as a favor. A favor to whom? Who was GAS? Can you please tell us the name?
So who is GAS?
We will proceed. They claim that GAS was 100% owned by a company called Presidio Capital, which is a hedge fund.
Okay. All right. Now, first, is this hearing devoted to just pinning down Bobby Ong Pin?
No. It's devoted to exposing the graft and corruption that went on during the time of Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, the behest loans that the DBP and the Land Bank extended, the anomalous situations where they were lending to companies that had a paid up capital of $2. They had no collateral for those loans. But these were the people's money. Land Bank and DBP are 100% owned by the Filipino people. Private banks would never do this. But here you are, a public bank, allowed and even encouraged to do this type of lending. We're also going to try to prove that the Ashmore funds belong to Mike Arroyo.
How are you going to prove that? But they're a big company.
Secret.
No, I mean Ashmore is a
Ashmore
big company.
No, Ashmore is a management.
Okay.
They manage about 25 to 30 funds. So they will organize a new fund. And if Karen Davila goes there and has $1 billion, Karen said, Ashmore, I'd like you to organize a fund for me and you manage it, or you let me manage it, but I want it under your name. Money laundering. Okay? All right. So they say, sure. Now here's Ashmore. They got huge investments in the Philippines. They own 40% of Alpha Land. And when I asked them during the last hearing, who's the Ashmore representative? Oh, they have none here. Where's their office? They have none. They've got billions invested in this country and they don't even have one solitary guy sitting here and looking after the interest. Hello, of course, because Bobby Yongpin is the representative of Ashmore here.
Okay. No, it's very interesting. But what I'm curious about right now is, how do you prove, let's say you do prove, I don't know if you're able to do it, but let's say you do prove that the Ashmore funds are Mike Arroyo funds, how do you connect it to former President Arroyo that will make her answer for these deals?
In the loan alone, that was granted, $180 million, so that's almost 8 billion pesos, that was granted by Land Bank and DBP to GAS, that alone, you're looking at a BHES loan situation, because kuding-kuning, they tried to make it look na may semblance of regularity because there was an executive order.
But did it have her approval?
Yes, an executive order was issued
for a loan.
181, yes, in 2005.
Yeah. All right. Okay.
Ayun, so, sabi ko, executive order pa, so hindi niya masasabi na hindi siya nag-order nito.
Uh-oh.
Because they all point, Malacanang said, Malacanang ordered. Now, if it is clearly anomalous, then you've got to pay the price.
Uh-oh. Now, based on the investigations you've done so far, does it prove in any way that Bobby Yongpin and Mike Arroyo are really business partners?
No, not yet.
Are you set to prove that?
Well, there are many, many stories. Of course, even Bobby Yongpin had to deny it, even in interviews before we even started our hearings, because people were talking about it, no? That he was the front for Mike Arroyo. So, I think we will get there.
Okay. All right. Now, let's go back first. I wanted to discuss the controversial MVP affidavit that came out in the papers, and you've discussed this also in the hearing, wherein Bobby Yongpin has said it proves nothing. That affidavit doesn't prove insider trading. Okay, let me... It is correct?
The document, the
affidavit,
the affidavit alone does not prove anything. You have to combine the affidavit with the SEC letter.
Okay. All right. Okay. I want to ask you first certain points of the affidavit, then you can take us through it. Okay. Mm-hmm. Number one, MVP had said that on the week of November 24, 2009, he received feelers from Mr. Bobby Yongpin and Eric Recto for an offer to sell about 550 million Philex shares, that's amounting to 10% of the voting stock, at an initial indicative price of 27 pesos per share. Is there anything questionable about that?
No. There was an offer at 27.
And by that time...
Offer to sell by Yongpin.
Offer to sell.
At 27, yes.
Okay. So
that's factual. No, there's nothing wrong with that. But the important part is that they decided on the price of 21.
Yes.
And they decided on the price towards the end of the week of November 24.
Yes, let me read it. Okay, so MVP had said that we had agreed on the final price of 21 pesos per share by the close of that week of November 24, 2009, which we have to remind the public, shares then were at 12.75? The Philex shares, something like that.
No. They were at 19 already.
Okay, all right. 19? They were
because
at 19?
Because I have... That's the next chapter. I will show that they were manipulating the price up.
Okay. All right. This is getting complicated. All right. No, but in this particular sentence first, will this prove in any way MVP had admitted they had agreed on a price? What is wrong with agreeing on a price when you are selling your shares?
Okay. No, there's nothing. Okay. Nothing wrong with agreeing on the price. What we're saying is that on November 27, they agreed on a price at 21 pesos per share. Mm-hmm. No violation.
No violation.
On December 2, knowing that there was going to be a deal at 21 pesos.
He bought more shares.
He bought more shares. 49 million shares of Felix.
And using loan, the money coming from DBP.
No.
Now, how did he buy?
It doesn't matter. He traded on knowledge not generally available to the public. That is the definition of insider trading.
So what you're...
Nakaupo siya sa Felix, director. Yeah.
He knew someone was buying it at 21.
Yeah. There is a rule, section 23.2, of the Securities Regulation Code. If you are a director or an officer, it is implied that you have access to inside trades, not to inside information. So therefore, you are not allowed to buy and sell, make a profit, or sell and buy and make a profit inside of 6 months.
Okay. All right.
That is called short swing trading profit.
Okay. Now it's getting much clearer. Okay, so clarify this. So November 24, 2009, there was an agreement already from MVP and Bobby Ongpin to buy it at 21 pesos per share.
That's correct.
550 million pesos worth of Felix shares.
Correct.
Okay? What you're saying is after that particular agreement...
After that date, yes.
That date, Bobby Ongpin bought additional shares and sold it to MVP?
I don't know, but he should not have bought additional shares because he was trading. We have not traced the exact movement of shares because we don't have the records yet from the SEC. But they can do that.
Yeah. Now, the questionable DBP loans would have to do with a second Bobby Ongpin's buying of shares the second time or the first?
The DBP loans, both.
Yes, both.
He borrowed 150 and he borrowed 510, total 660.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, the first loan paid the down payment for the second loan. So he didn't put a single cent in.
Oh my gosh. Okay. Now, what's interesting about this, actually, Leo Alejandrino sent me this question. And it's also very interesting because everybody is asking, why wouldn't MVP just approach DBP directly to buy their shares?
That's a $64 question.
Why would MVP have to buy it at such a high price?
SSS approached MVP and they said, we will sell to... MVP approached SSS. To this day, SSS owns 22% of Felix. They were the single biggest block.
Yes.
And Romineri said, no, we're not ready to sell this year, but maybe next year.
Okay.
So... At that time, Manny Pangilinan had about 31%, had accumulated already 31%. And he let the world know, I want to go to 40%. But he was limited because you're not supposed to breach 30% ownership. I forgot the rule. If you do that, then you're supposed to make a tender offer to everybody. Binili ko yung shares mo, umabot ako ng 30%. By law, I have to offer the same price to everybody. But if you wait 1 year, you can then accumulate more shares without having to make a tender offer.
Okay.
So the 1 year ended about December 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, around that time. Mm. So alam ng tao na makakabili ulit si Manny, alam natin na he wants an additional 10%. Ito yung presyo. Now remember the trading shares go up and down.
Yeah.
So pinasipa ngayon ni Bobby Ongpin at ni Ray David yung shares para umakyat. So it went from 12, 14, 16, 18, 19. That's price manipulation also.
But how could you prove that?
We'll have to get records of the trading, but we can prove that. And then they said that in the minutes, in the transcript of the minutes of the board meeting, he was bragging. Ah, pinaakyat namin yan. Tignan mo, 14, 16, 17, 19. Bobby Ongpin bought his 49 million shares on December 2 at 1925.
Okay.
Nobody in his right mind would spend that kind of money unless he knew that he'd be able to sell it for a higher price.
Okay,
because
okay.
Hindi pa tumatama, it never hit 21 in the market. The highest okay. price was 1925.
Mm-mm.
Now, why would you buy at 1925 in that volume? He knew 3 days later he would get paid at 21.
Yeah.
Of course I'll buy, sigurado.
That's
5%.
That's insider trading for you, huh?
Yeah.
Already. Because that this is...
What's that for me? That's the definition of the law.
Yes.
The law... Anywhere in the world, insider trading is defined as trading on information not generally available to the public.
Mm-hmm.
So suppose your friend at General Motors told mm-hmm. you, Karen, we're about to do a deal. Yeah. General Motors is about to buy Ford yeah. Motors. And nobody else knows about it. And Karen buys Ford Motors stock. You also
yeah.
are
no,
guilty of insider trading yeah. for having yeah.
no,
traded
I sold,
the information.
I told you earlier, I sold my Felix shares at such a low price. I didn't know MVP was going to buy it.
Right.
If I had known, I probably would have kept it.
Yep.
Now, the question with all of this, clearly you're making your point clear. Where will this lead?
Well, definitely
Is
it will lead to proposed amendments.
Is there an actual case for insider trading?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yes. I will hand over all the documents we collected. We may subpoena to the office of the ombudsman for them to
yeah.
use in whichever way they deem proper. At the same time, my purpose is to propose amendments to the law because you can see the law is just full of loopholes.
Okay. All right. Now let's move. Let's balance this by people have asked. Why are you obsessed with Bobby Ongpin, given that the loan was paid anyway? I know that there's a whole debate on that's not the definition of a BS loan, whether you pay it or not. But why don't you investigate other companies that were mentioned that have not paid their loans? I mean, to be fair, for example, there was a column in the Inquirer where some Lopez group of companies
yes.
had loans written out.
Yeah.
Why
written
not
off, yeah.
Written off. Why not investigate those loans too?
There's nothing wrong with writing off a loan, but I mean, I will investigate anything that the Senate asks me to investigate. The system in the Senate is that somebody files a resolution. Please check into this. He presents it to the Senate as a whole in plenary session. They vote on it. Then they say, which committee? This committee. I happen to be chair of Banks Committee,
mm-hmm.
so I had to undertake this investigation. From a fairness point of view, DBP already filed a case in the ombudsman about 2 to 3 months before the committee
mm-mm.
undertook.
Yeah, that's true.
All right.
That's true.
And ang sinabi ko, I'd like to see what's going on there because we're really going to have to amend the law. When I started looking and I asked my staff, ang daming butas, ang daming lusot ng law. I said, this will happen again and again unless we tighten up the provisions of law.
Mm-mm.
That's the General Banking Act, the Banco Central ng Pilipinas Charter,
mm-mm. Mm-mm.
the Securities Regulation Code,
mm-mm.
the Charter of the Development Bank of the Philippines, and the Charter of the Land Bank of the mm-mm. Philippines, among mm-mm. others. That's
okay.
already five laws
yeah,
that I have.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
All right.
Okay.
Now, the thing is, I'm not going to defend the Lopez Group. They have ABS-CBN to do that for them. But there were 10 billion, in that particular year, they wrote off 10 billion pesos. So the Alcantara Group was there. I think the FINMA Group was there. 300, 500, 1 billion, etc. This was the offshoot of the financial crisis of 1998,
okay.
1999.
Right.
So, hindi lang yung Lopez Group, pero very smart sila. Sabi nila, Osmeña yan, asawa niya Lopez.
Yeah.
So, palabasin
yeah.
natin. That was not behest. It was, all the banks were, the other banks wrote off the same Lopez loans also because they had loans with other commercial banks. So, that is a standard,
yeah.
normal
okay.
practice that banks do in order to be more realistic
yeah.
about the reporting in the balance sheet.
Yeah, okay. Now, but before we get to a break, a layman would be asking right now, why would I fault Bobby Ongpin for being smart and making so much money when at the very least that loan from a government bank, he fully paid?
Well, there are two parts there. One is the giving of the loan.
Okay.
So let me tell you a story. two guys come to you and they say, Ma'am Karen, lend me 1,000 pesos. Mm-hmm. So you lent each one 1,000 pesos. Yung isa po, binisnis niya. So he put up at the London Jew stand. Mm. He lost money.
Okay.
The other one, sinugal niya sa lottery. E nanalo. Binayaran ka.
Oh,
so you will punish the guy who legitimately lost money. Pero the other guy who gambled with your money and happened to make money,
okay,
you will reward him.
Wait, before we get to a break, why isn't MVP being called to testify?
Well, it's not us. I'm going to put that question before the committee. But
okay.
Senate
because
President Ponce Enrile said,
clearly,
perhaps we don't have to call him. I mean, if you left it up to me, I would call him.
Okay. So why? Because it seems really that there is favoritism or special treatment with some that Bobby Ongpin came to the hearing.
Yeah.
And you have, but then the committee has not called MVP.
The committee is not only Sir Chusmania, no?
Okay. All right.
There we'll are 19 members of the committee.
All right. We'll take a quick break. When we return, our guest, Senator Sir Chusmania,
yeah,
will answer questions from you, our viewers. Hot Copy will be right back.